Hey everybody, it's Jason Blaha here, and once again it is time for the Monday Q&As. So let's knock this out. First question, what is your opinion on benching flat-footed versus off your toes? Well, you guys know that I bench on my toes. However, what I'm going to say is that outside of a competitive environment, this comes down to personal preference, leverage, things like that. Some federations require you to be flat-footed in powerlifting, so if that's the case and that's how you compete, then you should probably train that way. As far as being on your toes, some people, myself included, feel like they can get tighter. We can get set in deeper. We can get our glutes set harder on the bench so that we can ratchet up tighter. And being tighter is a big part of building explosiveness and power. And a lot of that has to do with neuromuscular efficiency issues as far as like overall muscle fiber recruitment. Just like if you grip a bar a lot harder on a deadlift or something, you tend to be stronger. So it's like things like having your core tighter, having your grip tighter on things. In many cases, can have a change in neuromuscular efficiency and actually make you stronger, recruit more muscle fibers. So for me, I feel like I can get a lot tighter on my toes, and that's really what it comes down to is your personal biomechanics and personal preference in regards to that. That's going to vary from person to person. Whichever style lets you achieve the most tightness and to dig into the bench harder is probably going to be your best choice. But again, if you're a competitive powerlifter, the personal choice becomes less important than the rules of your federation, because you don't want to train in a way that you're not going to be able to compete with, because that's going to be potentially problematic for you in the long term. All right, next question. Do you think humans will progress to Star Trek type future, or will we war ourselves back into the Stone Ages? I would like to think that we as a species are better than that. However, I think religious wars and wars over religion are going to throw us back into the Stone Age, and eventually it's going to keep us from progressing to that point just because of the way that we as a species approach religions and religious conflicts in general. I think that is what is going to keep us from getting there. Unless, again, we have another fall, because, again, the Homo sapiens been here 200,000 years. We know that. We don't have recorded history going back more than about 10,000 years because we had a massive bottleneck and we had different cultures. So we don't know what cultures and things existed back then. We could have another big fall, another big event, and a new culture could rise up like what happened before and pretty much change the way that we do things and give us maybe one more shot at it. But as far as our current worldwide culture, until there's a big population bottleneck event again that pushes us back down, I don't think this current worldview, this culture that spawned out of coming out of ancient Sumeria, the first, basically the cradle of modern civilization, until this cultural concept that spread out and gave us the way that we look at religions and things, until it dies back off a bit, I don't think we have any chance of achieving that. All right, next question. Five best exercises for wrestlers. Wrestlers and just most contact sports, because there are elements that overlap, whether you're talking about wrestling, MMA, boxing, whatever. I would say that probably the five best exercises, and I really hate to limit people to five exercises. I mean, if you want to be a good athlete, you need to do every exercise that's going to give you an advantage. But what five would I put the most focus on? What would be the most important if you were to throw me some wrestlers right now and say train them in the weight room? Probably be the conventional deadlift, obviously beltless. I wouldn't let a contact sport athlete ever wear a belt. So beltless conventional deadlifts, power cleans, front squats, push presses, and maybe like weighted pull-ups. Those would be the five that I would have them do for a host of reasons that will cover all their basic movements, that will make them explosive, that will make them powerful, that will give them strong core, strong backs, and just well-rounded power and strength, which is what they need. It's not necessarily their conditioning work. They would be doing separate conditioning work because wrestlers actually need conditioning. But as far as their actual strength training in the gym, those would be the five exercises that I would put the most focus on if I had to limit it to five. But again, I obviously wouldn't limit it to five. All right, next question. Do ketones eat cancer cells and thus prevent the development of cancer and possibly even cure it in any cases? This is kind of an interesting question, and it comes back to our point about diets, because a lot of people always worry that things like ketogenic style diets would cause various diseases and cancers, and we have found quite the opposite to be true. Now, one of the things that was hypothesized a number of years back was that the impact that ketogenic style diets have on circulating insulin and things like that could be useful in slowing tumor growth. And so studies have been done on that based upon that hypothesis. over the years, and they did find that ketogenic style diets for certain types of cancer, not all cancers, but many types of cancers, seem to help reduce cancer growth and use concurrently with cancer treatments at a higher rate of success. But when it's been looked at further, there has been some emerging data suggesting that not just about circulating insulin and things like that, the ketones themselves seem to, in some cases, do something with the tumors. I'm not saying they eat the tumors. I don't know if that's the correct term, and I don't think we understand this further. We need further studies on this. But there are trials and studies out there being worked with right now that are actually injecting ketones directly in the bloodstream to see how that helps with tumors and things. And it looks promising. We're going to need more data over time to see how that helps. But as far as ketogenic diets and ketones go, they do seem to actually help with fighting cancer. And again, as more data emerges, I think it's going to be interesting. I'm going to be keeping an eye on it personally, and I will probably be discussing that on the channel because we're talking about a nutrition component, an actual style of dieting that might actually be therapeutically useful in treating something that destroys health and kills people. And I think that's what fitness is should really be all about. We need to be focusing upon how our diets and lifestyles give us higher quality of life, keep us alive longer, and again, improve that quality of life as we live longer. That's what fitness is. Fitness is not about having the nicest abs so that you can be on the cover of a magazine. All right, next question. Hey Jason, over the last few months, it seems as if I have built up this habit of leaning to the right on my squat. This problem has now grown larger and is causing me knee pain. What would you recommend doing to this lean? All right, what you need to do, you need to start back over. You are now learning bad techniques, bad habits, because you're probably shifting because you're using a weight that's too heavy for you to use. I'm going to recommend two things. Number one, start doing a lot more core work. Your core is too weak. You've got problems with your various erectors in your back, your abs, your obliques, things like that. You need to be doing a lot more core work. Core is a problem. Number two, you've got to just stop with your progress for a while. Your technique is one that's going to hurt you over time. You need to drop the weight back probably 30, 40, maybe even 50% of what you're using and spend a month focusing and concentrating on doing your normal set. So if you cut the weight back, don't say you think you're going to go do 20 rep sets because you're going to fall right back into your bad habit. You're going to have to just lose progress for a while. You're going to have to cut the weight back and consciously focus on every single rep, maintaining it evenly and doing this until you ingrain the motor patterns over the next month or two to prevent this from happening. It's just you learned a bad technique, a bad habit, probably because you're trying to grind out weights that are too heavy for you without focusing on good form while you were getting stronger. And so now you got to pay the price. You're going to have to rechange what you're doing so that you don't injure yourself. And unfortunately, that's the way these things go sometimes when you learn bad habits in the gym. Your other choice is to not take that advice and keep doing it till you get hurt. And then you can be one of those guys who talks about how much weight you used to lift until you got hurt. You know, I used to be an adventurer like you till I took an arrow to the knee. All right, next question. Does squatting ass to grass increase spinal hypertrophy since erectors are stretching and contracting during butwink? Deep squats in general increase erector hypertrophy. You're putting a direct load on the erectors. In the case of those deeper squats like that, where you do get some butwink, as people call it, which is oftentimes posterior pelvic tilt. Yeah, because you're putting a heavy load on it and you're contracting it under that load, it will increase the hypertrophy of it. What I will point out, though, if you are going to be squatting in that manner, make sure that you're probably doing some additional lower back and core work so that you're actually thickening it through other methods so that you strengthen it to help prevent injury. But to answer the question, yes, it could be, but it shouldn't be your primary hypertrophy work for your spinal erectors. All right, next question. What would you use a snatch grip deadlift and what are the benefits? I don't personally use it. The snatch grip deadlift, though, is good for training yourself to pull from a lower position. It, in a lot of ways, I would use it for the same purposes that many people use a deficit deadlift for. In some ways, they're a tool that can overlap, not completely, but similar purpose. It's training yourself to get more explosive off the floor because obviously a snatch grip deadlift, you have to use a lighter weight and you have to get lower to the floor to pull it. I personally think the deficit deadlift is a better tool for this purpose, but the snatch grip deadlift can be used to improve explosiveness off the floor because, again, you're having to pull from a lower position, a biomechanically weaker position, and pull more explosively to do so. I think where it fits in better for many people outside of that would be for, again, Olympic lifters because they need to be doing a lot of various snatch grip work to improve their snatch. So for them, the snatch grip deadlift. In not all of cases, but some coaches would use it as a tool to improve their snatch. All right, guys, that's all my normal questions. I threw in a bonus question at the end. The next three questions out of the 10 normal ones are going to be like gear, TRT, SARM related questions. A lot of you might find them interesting, but some people don't. If you don't, then try them on out. And then my last question, because I've been doing videos on my firearm channel again, someone asked a gun question. I know a lot of you hate guns. You don't like guns. So I threw it in at the end, so it's really easier for you to skip it and not have to hear it. But I think it's a very good question. All right. Next question. What are your thoughts on Jerry Ward pushing SARMs? I've only heard this in rumor. I've seen him link a couple things on his wall. I haven't spoken with Jerry about it personally. I haven't seen what he's pushing with it. I don't know why he's doing it outside of making a profit. If we're trying to promote SARMs as automatically safer than testosterone and gear, I don't necessarily agree with that. If we're promoting them as being a more cost-effective version of making gains, I also wouldn't agree with that. It might be something that's being pushed purely for a legality purpose because there are legal loopholes right now for some SARMs in the U.S., but this is purely about getting people drugs to get anabolic or steroid-like gains with possible steroid-like side effects. And let's not pretend like SARMs don't have side effects. And the reality is we haven't studied them as long as we have anabolics. With anabolics, we know the overall risk. We know how to assess the risk. People know what they're getting into. With SARMs, because we don't have the long-term data, we don't know fully what we're getting into here and what the long-term risk and things are going to be. And they're probably going to end up having their own set of side effects unique to SARMs and issues that they cause over time. So I'm not real big on promoting it. I can understand from a business model perspective why someone might do it to make money. But if people are trying to automatically assume that they're going to give you all the gains of steroids without any of the risk or any side effects, that's not necessarily going to be true. They are going to be weaker than gear. There's no way for SARMs to be a strong milligram for milligram of testosterone. They tend to be a little on the expensive side from what I've seen. So it's purely about legality purposes. But you know what? Since they do build muscle, that legal loophole is only temporary. Since all these companies are cranking them out, what's going to end up happening, they're going to be felony level things to possess without a prescription in the near future anyways. All the lawmakers are going to see this. It's going to come out. It's going to be reported. And they're just going to make them illegal anyways. And so your source is going to dry up for them now. I'm sure Jerry's just cashing in on it while he can. Hell, I should probably be doing the same thing now that I think about it. But I don't know. I'm not sure if I'm comfortable doing that. All right, next question. I'm on TRT. My test is 735. I'm assuming that's nanograms for deciliters. Yeah, I get 200 milligrams of test sip every 2 weeks, and my endocrinologist won't up the dose to weekly. Do I look for a new doctor? The swings are brutal on 49. You need to explain to your doctor that a lot of other doctors out there, a lot of endocrinologists do it weekly because of the brutal spikes and lowering, and particularly that final 3 or 4 days before your next shot really sucks on a every 2 week regimen of TRT. If your endocrinologist can't be made to explain this, you're either going to need to tell him to screw off and either go find a new endocrinologist who will do it correctly, or you're going to have to do it yourself. I don't necessarily recommend you doing the latter, but at a certain point, your mood and your health and your well-being are at stake, and your doctor's not doing what endocrinologists know is going to give you the best results. This is well understood at this point in terms of injection frequency. Then you're going to have to do something different. You're going to have to find a means to do it, because if you're really having the issues with it that a lot of guys have, it is pretty brutal, and it's going to destroy your sex drive, your mood, even potentially your health, to have, you know, 5 or 6 days every month to where you, your levels crash because of the long injection frequency. Then you're going to have to do something about it, because it's just unacceptable to suffer with that. And again, you're either going to need to find another doctor who is willing to work with you on that, and there are a lot of endocrinologists who will, or you're going to have to do something else. All right, next question. Jason, what are your thoughts on cycling AAS, that means anabolic androgenic steroids, and keeping your gains without passing your genetic limit? I often hear people say that you pass your genetic limit, that you will not keep any of those gains. Well, how about if you didn't pass the genetic limit? Would cycling be worth it? Look, guys, I don't recommend people cycle at all. Cycling is the most asinine internet concept that was ever come up with. It's just silly. I've said that. You heard Mark Lobliner say that. This is internet bullshit from forums. It's probably the worst gear theory and philosophy of use that's ever come out of the internet. But as far as there's some misconceptions there. Once you start utilizing gear, what we found, and there's research on this, there's data on this out there, that actually it changes your limits. Most guys who are on gear don't ever reach probably their full genetic limits, natural limits even on the gear. Because again, the studies we have, the average steroid user still has a fat-free mass index of less than 25, even when their body fat's above 10%. You know, we had determined already that people at 10% or lower body fat, a fat-free mass index is probably the limits for people with elite genetics. Appears to be the case. When you go higher body fats, people with really good genetics can go higher than a 25. When they get lean, it's down around 25. The average steroid user has in studies at all body fats, just going across the board, seem to have a fat-free mass index of about 24.5 regular long-term users. So what does that tell you about them passing their limits? Most of them probably aren't, or they're right at their natural genetic limit. They've just gotten there quicker. But the thing is, once people start utilizing these drugs, we know that they make semi-permanent changes. So you see it, one of the biggest changes we've seen in studies is that even 2 or 3 years after they come off completely, people who used for significant amounts of times, they have a larger number of nuclei in their muscle cells. They have a larger number of nuclei in the muscle cells. That is a permanent change. So once you've made a permanent structural change to the muscle tissue with these drugs, what your previous genetic limits might have been are actually altered at this point, because you have altered yourself somewhat permanently at this point. You're not natural again just because you come off completely. Not to say that guys don't lose a lot of gains every time they cycle off no matter what, but to say that they can't go above their natural limits and stay there isn't true. And I've seen many cases of guys who used long-term and they came off and went on TRT or something, who are still well above a 25 fat-free mass index, even though they've been off the real gear for quite a few years. More normal than you might think. So a lot of these big guys who are out there who are just on TRT, it's because they ran a lot of gear when they were younger. Now they're on TRT and they're still sitting at 20 pounds or 25 pounds more muscle mass than their frame should be able to hold. More common than people think. All right, guys, last question of the week, throwing in as a bonus question instead of 10, I did 11. If you hate guns and you're anti-gun, just chime out. And I'm probably going to answer this question in more detail later on my tactical channel. All right. Hey, Jason, this isn't exactly a fitness related, but I was looking to buy a new handgun for self-defense. I originally planned on getting a Glock 19, but someone recommended I go with a Glock 23. I know from your video that a Glock 19 is a good choice. I wanted to know if there would be any reason to get the 23 over the 19. All right. You guys know I own a number of handguns. The Glock 19 is not even my most expensive handgun. The most expensive one I currently have is a M&P 9 VTAC. This is not currently my everyday carry piece. This is not currently my bedside piece. This is one that kind of, this is a shelf queen at this point. I don't even shoot this gun anymore. It's a nice piece. It's the most expensive thing I own. It wouldn't be the piece that I trust my life to. I carry a Glock 19. This is what is my everyday carry piece. This is my console piece. This is my bedside piece. This is my first line of defense. How strongly do I feel about that choice? This is my girlfriend's gun. This is also a Glock 19. This is the firearm that I have her carry because this is what I trust to defend my girlfriend's life, not just my own. So we both carry the Glock 19. What does that tell you about my choice over the 23? Means that I think the 19 is a better choice. Now, we could argue about personal preference all day long as far as the 40 caliber round versus a 9mm. That might be fine for a personal choice because you're like, well, I get more firepower, but you actually don't. I get two less rounds in the firearm, in the magazine, because it's a larger diameter. But I have to deal with more recoil and more wear and tear on the gun. And the 23 has simply never been as reliable as the 19. The Glock 19 and the Glock 17 are currently probably the most reliable and dependable firearm platform on the planet. And what I mean is that they have the fewest hangups, the fewest misfires. They can generally take the most abuse, the most rounds put through them before they break. Their reliability is second to none. That is why I trust my life to this. The problem with the Glock 23, that is the exact same firearm with a larger caliber bullet. The breech, the action, everything is the exact same piece of metal, same diameter, but with a larger hole drilled through it. So you have less metal surrounding the cartridge when it fires. combined with the fact that the 40 SNW is a much higher pressure cartridge. It is less reliable because you have less metal surrounding the cartridge, you have a higher pressure cartridge, it puts more wear and tear on the firearm, it wears out faster, has a higher chance of an issue, particularly if you get cheaper ammo that hasn't been loaded correctly. If there's loading, pressure loading inconsistencies in the 40 SNW, this is what used to blow locks up years ago, because they were originally designed to be a 9mm platform. So you are losing reliability. You're dealing with more recoil for slower follow-up shots, less reliability, two less rounds to have. So two less rounds equals less firepower. Now, the perception that you're getting more stopping power, the FBI just simply disagrees. The FBI has spent millions of dollars researching this. They finally put out their findings last year. The FBI is going all the way back to 9mm. They feel that for law enforcement and personal defense, it is the most effective round out there. We know the data shows that now when you use the best ammo out there, that 9mm causes just as much tissue trauma as 40 SNW and 45 ACP when all of them use the best ammo that's available out there, premium ammunition. The debate is over. So I carry 9mm. And again, you could argue about the personal preference, but if you have a firearm that you're going to have someone else use, such as your girlfriend, your wife, it might be fine for a guy who lifts weights for you to go with the 40 SNW and deal with the snappier recoil. You can make those compromises for no benefit because you just feel better with the larger caliber. However, if you have your girlfriend or wife start using the same platform, I like to standardize my platforms as much as possible. If she needs to utilize your firearm or you need overlap of accessibility using each other's magazines, fumbling with magazines in the dark if someone kicks in your door at 2 in the morning, being standardized is a good thing. Your girlfriend may not be able to handle the snappiness and recoil on the Glock 23 over the 19. So my recommendation is generally going to be towards the 19. It's what I personally trust my life to, is my front line of defense. It is what I trust my girlfriend's life to. So I see no reason for you to pick the 23 over the 19, but it comes down to your preference. It wouldn't be mine. All right, guys, but that's really all I have to say on that today. I hope it's been informative, and I will talk to you guys next time.